Hi. Welcome to Opera Happy Hour. My name is Jeremy Frank. I am the Associate Chorus Master at LA Opera, and I'm thrilled to welcome you to episode 5 of Opera Happy Hour. As you know, each week I pick a theme, and we spend about half an hour discussing how that theme finds its way through the operatic repertoire. And of course, we do a drink pairing, because it is Happy Hour after all. Today, if you haven't guessed it already, we're tackling how dance and opera intersect, and we're making it a dance party. Those of you who know me at all are going to find this just slightly ironic, because while I love music wildly, dancing gives me the hives. It makes me so nervous. So, if my husband Nathan and I ever go out to a bar and you see us, you are likely to see me with today's pairing, which is a well drink. And my well drink of choice is vodka and tonic. And just because I actually don't know what to do with both of my hands when I'm dancing, this is my left hand drink. My right hand drink is a water chaser, so that as I dance and work it out, I don't even have to worry about what to do with my hands. So feel free to drink, to get two of your favorite drinks. It's that kind of episode. And we'll get underway. In the meantime, cheers. As all of you undoubtedly know, dance is an ancient tradition that goes back all the way to antiquity. And though the operatic tradition only stretches back about 420 years or so, dance has played an important role in our art form since the earliest days of opera. Now, this subject is just so big, we could spend many, many episodes, and perhaps we will, on the relationship between dance and opera, but today I thought we would do one particular angle of it, and that is how composers use dance to depict character, which is truly, truly fascinating. And to illustrate the points that I'd like to talk about today, I thought we would choose two of the most famous operas that there are. First, Bizet's Carmen, written in the late 19th century. And then in the second half of the show, we'll talk about Don Giovanni, where Mozart, who was an amazing dancer himself, wrote one of the most intricate and deceptively simple sounding and beautiful mashup of dances that has ever been written. It's easy to see why Carmen is one of the top 5 operas ever performed. It's about a toxic relationship between the title character Carmen and this guy who catches her interest, Don Jose. He turns out to be a really bad egg, and because of that, it's also a story about being dumped and the revenge that you want to seek, and in Don Jose's case, he actually does seek it. So because of that, if you've ever been in high school and had a really crappy first breakup, this is a story that you can easily relate to. Not only that, but Carmen also has tune after tune that are super famous. You will undoubtedly recognize most of the melodies that I'm about to sing and play for you in today's episode. And as it turns out, most of them are constructed from dance rhythms. And that is partly why I was really eager to get them into today's show. One major component of Carmen that is important to address immediately when you start talking about it is that most of the characters of the show are drawn from the Romani community. In the 19th century, Bizet is certainly not alone in drawing characters and taking themes from what was then called the Gypsy community. We would certainly never call it that now, though some members of that community do use that term to refer to themselves. But the interesting thing in Bizet's telling of a story about these characters is that he clearly depicts them to be more true to themselves, genuine, authentic, and outside of the conventions of Western European culture. He absolutely lionizes them, and they are, for better or worse, and mostly for better, the heroes of this story. One of them, Carmen, as I said earlier, happens to sing most of her songs in dance. And because Bizet wanted to pair this exotic and authentic character with exotic sounding music, we get some of the most amazing and new dances of the day. And I thought we would spend the first part of today's show talking about the first four times that we hear Carmen sing solo repertoire and investigate the dances that are behind them. The first of Carmen's four dances is the Habanera, which is one of the most famous tunes in Western music. You're certain to recognize it. The dance Habanera became very popular in the 1870s, which happens to be the same decade that Bizet was writing Carmen. And in fact, the Habanera as a dance is very close to the tango. You'll recognize the little cell of rhythm in my left hand that links those two dances together. And because of that, it means that the original origins of this dance come from sub-Saharan Africa, actually. It's very sensuous, it's very exotic and sultry, and when you think about what Carmen is saying and what this song reveals of her character, it's a really tight fit. In this song, Carmen has not yet met Don José, and so she is singing to other people that she works with at the cigarette factory. And there are a bunch of men around, soldiers, who are infatuated with Carmen. They've come to hear her philosophy of love, which is that love is like a rebellious bird. If you try to catch it, it will escape you. But if you just wait and appear uninterested, it will come to you whether you want it to or not. You'll recognize this tune for sure. I'm going to sing the entire first verse. And for those of you who know this piece, there is a very famous chorus that accompanies the second half of this verse. If you happen to know the words, please feel free to sing along. But when I play very loud at the piano, you should know that what the chorus is singing is, "Watch out for her." It sounds something like this. Carmen's second dance also appears in Act One after José has been forced to arrest her for causing a fight at the cigarette factory. The dance is a seguidilla, and it is a Spanish dance, and it's actually a dance of courtship. So it's interesting that Bizet depicts Carmen using it to start to manipulate and seduce José. The song is in an ABA form. And at first, her hands are bound behind her back. She's a prisoner. And she sings sort of flirtingly and non-directly about what her weekend plans are going to be. And they're going to be tremendously boring. And she wishes she had a guy there that she could spend a little bit of time and get to know. In the B section, she lays it on pretty thick and implies to José that he should be that guy. And by the time that she reaches the return of the A section, she has managed to sneak her way out of these handcuffs and is confidently singing that she is indeed going to go with José to her friend Lilas Pastia's house, where they will drink wine and have a great weekend. It sounds something like this.
She lay dancing a singe di mare di Mosania. She lay shimona di Lilas Pastia.
Of course, José's superiors in the army are none too impressed that he has been bamboozled by Carmen and that she has managed to make her escape. He's imprisoned for 3 months, and as we start Act Two, we hear the chanson bohémienne. In French of the time, bohémienne was one of the terms that Bizet and other composers used to refer to the Romani community, mostly because at that time in Europe, they had been living in Bohemia. And you probably know the famous opera, La Bohème, which actually doesn't mean that the whole piece is about Romani. Instead, it means something about freewheeling, peace-loving artist types, people who have a free spirit, who value liberty above all. And at the beginning of Act Two of Bizet's Carmen, we actually see Carmen with a group of her friends, and it is the exact depiction of that kind of life philosophy. They sing the chanson bohémienne. It is a song that happens in three verses, and it sort of starts out as if it's really, really hot, as it has been in LA lately. Everybody is a little bit too lazy to get worked up into dancing. And so the first verse starts in this kind of sultry tempo, but as they talk about the instruments that will be accompanying the dance and how it will feel to dance and the great feeling that it's going to cause and how it will awaken all of their senses, the song gets faster and faster and faster. It picks up speed like a snowball going downhill. And by the end, everybody is rollicking around and dancing with complete delight. Absolutely impossible to resist. Here's how it sounds. Song that I'd like to sing for you, fourth song and dance that I'd like to sing for you, which happens toward the end of Act Two. Carmen actually does some more manipulation, but in a way it's ingenious because it's a song that sounds like it's for herself while at the same time being exactly for José and for his benefit. What's happened is José has taken his time of leave to come find Carmen again and profess his love for her. He tells her that he's been obsessed with her for the 3 months that he's been in jail and can't think of anything else other than her. And she says, really, if you want to prove it, then you should desert and you should come follow me and all of my fellow Bohemiennes. And he thinks about it for a while and doesn't think he should do it. But she sings this song that I'm about to sing for you. And she manages to make it so that it fits exactly in time with the bugle call that is calling him back from his break. She also does this very sensuous dance during it, and she accompanies herself using castanets, which are they're a percussion instrument that are handheld. They're two pieces of hard wood, usually chestnut, that are held on a string in each hand, and they look like little clamshells. And when you click them, they make rhythms, and so you can do da-ga-da-ga-da-ga-da-ga-da-ga, or things like that. Now, I don't have any castanets at home, but it is super important to the song, because she tells José that she is going to accompany herself with the castanets. So, I brought out my good old wooden bowl and some wooden spoons. And so I'm going to accompany myself while I sing Carmen's fourth song. It goes something like this. La, 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 la 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 la. There's an interesting difference between the way that dance depicts character in Carmen from the way that it depicts character in Don Giovanni. In Bizet's instance, he's using these dances that come from African and Cuban and Spanish origin to evoke a sense of otherness and exoticism. In a way, he's looking to other cultures to be able to comment on French culture of his day. In contrast, Don Giovanni is commenting on the culture of its day by using the dances of its time and of its own social strata. One of the most amazing things occurs in the end of the Act One finale of Don Giovanni. It's technically called a quodlibet, which is a Latin term that means something that is pleasing to the ear. But what it is, essentially, is just a mashup of three dances that shouldn't go together, but do. And Mozart is very, very particular about which dances he chooses. Now, Mozart was a great dancer himself. He also composed a ton of music for dance, but this is by far his most ambitious tool. You need to know a little bit about the story of Don Giovanni for it to make sense. So at the beginning of Don Giovanni, we meet Don Anna and Don Ottavio. And Don Giovanni, who is a very famous Lothario, he tries to put the make on all sorts of women, and in fact has succeeded thousands of times. He has tried to get his way with Anna, and she has fought him off. And they don't know his identity. So over the course of Act One, they try to figure out who it is, and they're fairly certain it's Don G. And they're going to a party to try to confront him. One of the dances, then, in this finale is a very courtly dance called a minuet that happens in three-quarter time. In fact, it has a characteristic rhythm that I'm going to show you, not by dancing it, but I'm going to show you with my fingers. So it was known for its teensy-tiny steps and this particular rhythm. Da, ba 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 da. Ba 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 da. And if you were dancing that rhythm, chances were good that you were dancing a minuet. It was something that was danced in the court and was really reserved for noble people. So at the beginning of this quadlibet, Giovanni uses that music to dance elegantly with them and try to avoid their suspicions and being figured out as the one who tried to attack Don Anna. What he really wants to do is put the make on a young woman named Zerlina, who is a peasant girl, and she is engaged to be married to Mazzetto, who is also at this party. So after sort of dealing with the noble characters, Don Giovanni starts to put the make on Zerlina. And he does so by dancing a different dance in a completely different meter. This is a contra dance, and it's sort of like an old version of line dancing. It's like the electric slide of its time. And because he uses this very social dance to dance with her, he can get close to her without raising too much suspicion. Now, Mazzetto is no dummy, and he knows what's up. And so he wants to start to pick a fight and defend his lady. Meanwhile, Giovanni's henchman, Leporello, starts dancing with Mazzetto in a third dance, in a third meter, as a distraction. And that dance is a very frantic, very fast dance called a German dance, which was a dance that only peasants did. And somehow these three pieces of music go together miraculously in an interlocking unit. Now that I have a little bit of modern technology at my disposal, I'm able to show you how the magic of this quadlibet works, with its three dances in completely different styles depicting the three different social strata of the various characters involved. The first thing that you'll hear is the minuet dance, danced by all of the noble characters. It is in 3/4 time. So at first, I'll count to show you the meter, and then when the characters start to sing, I'll give a little bit of color commentary about what they're saying. You'll have to imagine me wearing 6 or 7 different hats, because the words that I say will be reflecting exactly what each character's perspective is at any given time. After that, you'll hear Orchestra 2 start tuning on the acoustic instrument. And after they've tuned, they join with the second dance, the one that Don Giovanni uses to try to seduce Zerlina with. That dance is in 2/4 time, so while I play, I'll count out that meter while this keyboard instrument continues to play in the other meter. Overlapping that music is Orchestra 3 starting to tune, and when they join in, they play in a third, very fast, very frenetic meter. And when that happens, I'll just simply jump to their part. And if I'm able to, I'll even count out a few measures of what fast rhythm they're thinking as they play. It sounds something like this. And they This has whet your appetite to dust off your dancing shoes and work it out just a little bit. I would love to do another episode where we talk more in depth about the relationship between ballet specifically and opera. But before we do that, tune in next week when I'll be talking about opera murder mysteries. The drink pairing is really great there. And if you haven't had a chance to check it out, please check out the LA Opera Relief Fund, where any donation goes directly to help artists who are struggling through this time. Of course, only make a donation if you're able to make a donation, but if you are able, we're very, very grateful. In the meantime, have a great week and cheers.